Brothers and sisters, we welcome you to this beautiful day to celebrate the life of Sister Krista Nicole Quintana. This funeral service today. We have just come from the family prayer, which was offered by Brother Spencer Blanchard. We'd like to thank our musicians today for the music. Presiding at this meeting is President Stephen Vaudry. He is also our state president. And I, Bishop Thomas, will be conducting. We'd like to thank Sister Crystal Lunn for being our chorister today. We will start our program today by singing hymn, How Great Thou Art, page 86, after which Sister Miriam Quintana will offer the invocation.
Thank you. Nuestro Padre Celestial, estamos muy agradecidos, Padre, por tu obra y por la ordenanza que tenemos para aquí en la tierra. Gracias, Padre, porque diste la oportunidad de poder tener un cuerpo aquí en la tierra. Gracias por ti, amado Padre. Gracias por ella y por haber nacido en la familia Lanza. Gracias por ella, amado Padre, y agradecemos por tu plan y por tu amor que tienes por cada uno de nosotros. Rogamos, Padre, de que tú des consuelo y paz para la familia, para que podamos entender que tú tienes un propósito para nosotros. Y ese propósito es de volver a tu presencia y ser una familia eterna. Gracias, Padre, por todo ello y rogamos estas bendiciones en nombre de tu Hijo Jesucristo. Amén.
Thank you, Sister Quintana. The program will go as follows today. We will first have a life sketch by Terry and Trish Blanchard, after which Memories of Crystal will be shared by Sister Kaylee Hepworth. We'll then have a musical selection, My Heavenly Father Loves Me, performed by nieces and nephews, and accompanied by Allison Moody and directed by Natalie Schradel. Then we will have a tribute by Kenny Quintana. And we work to that point. Brother and Sister Blanchard.
Such dear friends, and all the rest of you
all friends who have been so supportive. We feel very, very blessed to be surrounded by a worldwide set of friends and family who love and support Krista and Candy and all of us. Krista Quintana passed away on May 9th, 2023, at the age of 34. She was in the loving care of her husband, Candy Quintana, at the Stonehenge of Springville Nursing Facility, under the care of wonderful, wonderful hospice nurses and support staff, and the great nurses and CNAs at Stonehenge. We're so grateful. We became close friends to all of them. Krista's sparkling smile and her high energy, her zest and love for life, and her heartfelt caring all around her made her beloved to everyone who knew her. Most of all, she was a follower of our Savior Jesus Christ. She lived to follow his example throughout her life. She was an amazing and faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Krista was born near here in Provo, Utah, but at the age of 6 months moved to Colorado, where she grew her entire formative years in Fort Collins, Colorado. She's the eldest of our children. She loved being a big sister, and she was very responsible for her age, and I think her sisters might say she was a little bossy at times. And brother, yes. The brother had five mothers. She was a delightful child with a quick laugh and a zest for life. And throughout her life, one of the really key things you would always notice about her was her very wide-open smile. It was captivating. Another very significant characteristic of her that was very impressive was her very thick, dark, black hair, beautiful hair. When she was seven, her dearest friend, and I don't know how two little children can be such dear friends, but her dear friend, Marissa Kushnick, passed away with cancer. And Krista felt so deeply as we went to the hospital and saw the patients suffering and going through chemo and losing their hair. She said, "I'm going to cut my hair every time it grows a foot, and I'm going to donate it to Locks of Love so that someone who's going through cancer can have hair." And she did it about every 18 months. It's how long her hair grows very fast. She donated more than 12 feet of hair over the course of her life, which is more than twice her height. Quite amazing. And she kept that promise. Even when she went through her own chemo, she somehow kept her hair. She was probably a blessing because of that kindness. Krista had many talents and interests. She excelled in all academic areas, but reading, writing, and music were her passions. She was a voracious reader. Kenny and I were looking the other day on her phone, and she would be somewhere between 150 and 200 books a year, just always constantly reading and loving it. She never stopped reading, and she was at a grade school level, was reading adult and teen level reading, going through books as fast as she could. It was a challenge for her mom to keep finding good books for her to read before she finished all the last ones that she had read. And then she started writing her own books in high school, and the one that she recently published was started in high school. And she has two published books and 10 manuscripts in different levels of completion.
So one of Krista's talents was music. She learned to play the piano at a young age, although not necessarily the music her piano teacher had assigned her. She liked to sing and participate in choirs. She did that for many years. The family always knew when Krista got home, because if it was from early morning seminary or any activity, she would open the garage door and we could just hear her singing at the top of her lungs. And she was singing everywhere, doing everything. And I can't remember which child it was, because Krista was sitting at the table. So they started to sing and said, "Krista, don't sing at the table, you might choke and die." So we couldn't sing at the table because Krista might choke and die because she was singing. She loved to watch the opera and musicals. Begged us to go to Utah during opera season, and Uncle Eric was in the hit and get us discount tickets, and she would try to go to two or three of the operas and musicals there at Eccles. And, it was kind of a rite of passage, and she just loved it so much. And the first time poor baby Spencer was old enough to go to an opera, it was actually a musical, and it was 3 hours, and afterwards, he said, "Krista, I can't believe you went to this your whole life. It was the most boring thing ever." So she set great expectations that not everyone appreciated those things. She had, growing up, she had three loves, actually. She loved genealogy, she loved geology, and she loved geriatric nursing. Now, when you're in kindergarten, you might say you want to be a nurse, but you might not say you want to be a geriatric nurse. And my father said, "So Krista, you can take care of me when I'm older." And she said, "Grandpa, you'll be dead." So, she did need to work on her bedside manner. She loved geology, like I said, and she would go to rock shows and she would collect rocks and people would give her rocks and she would study how to categorize these rocks and the hardness scale, and she would have little, test kits to see how pure things were. And she, you know, you have a card catalog, she has one with all of her rocks. They're in drawers. They're in drawers. Drawers, and then and then we have rocks. But she loved to identify and file them. So our family, with our five children, we participated in the Melbourne pageant for a number of years, and she loved that. She enjoyed the history of Nauvoo and the early saints, and loved the spirit she felt there. We had the opportunity, and we participated in the pageant as family cast the first year in 2005, and the next year we'd offered our children the opportunity to go to Hawaii the next summer, and they said, "No, we won't go back to the pageant." And then our youngest children said, "I never heard about Hawaii." but they loved their type and Nauvoo as well. So Krista loved to bake and developed a great skill in making pies. She would make sometimes 12 or 14 pies for Thanksgiving, as well as the rolls. But she would make duplicate pies as well and give them out. Started baking day tradition in our family, and friends would come until everyone graduated from high school, I think, that they would come the day before Thanksgiving, and everyone would make pies and rolls and take them home to their families. Everyone especially loved to be the tasters for Krista. She developed her wedding cake skills and other things, and so you lucky few who lived by her when she was learning those skills benefited from that. Probably gained a few pounds as well. And she loved Thanksgiving. She would have Thanksgiving a couple of times a year. She would capture stories for family history, the genealogy part. She would transcribe manuscripts and post them and organize pictures and feature as well, made them available to our family electronically and did family calendars and pictures as well. She did become a geriatric nurse. She became a nurse and served in many ways. She served in geriatrics, hospice, oncology, med-surg, short-term rehabs at NYC, cardiac and director of nursing. She loved her patients. She tolerated the paperwork. She loved her coworkers and her patients because she was a healer. So Krista received many opportunities to go to different colleges, and it was a great leap of faith to send her to Madrid to go to college to pursue an international nursing degree. So when I hear people whining that they have to send their child 8 hours or 2 hours away to school, I just remember sending her to Spain. When we were going to the airport, her children lined up and said, "God be with you till we meet again." And I'll remember that because I think they were stood in the line and saying that to her again this time. Because we know we'll see her again. She's really involved in YSA activities at the Institute while she was in Spain. I think when she arrived, there were about 5 people who were going to Institute, and when she left, there was about 35. Kenny and Krista met when they were learning dances for a dance recital that they were partnered up and he couldn't speak English and she couldn't speak Spanish, but they were able to communicate. He taught her English while Spanish while they were in Spain, and she taught him English while he was American. Keep going, Kenny. And she would also call us for money to fund her activities in Spain because they didn't have enough money. So saying, "Mom, I have this great idea for this activity. I just don't have any money." So we were happy to support those activities. It was amazing also while she was in Spain one time, she was in their board, and there was an American was there and asked her to translate, which she did, and then he asked if she would take him to the temple, to see the temple, and she could a little bit after her church meetings and stuff, and they were talking on the metro, and she showed him a picture of a family, and he said, "Clarence Catwick is your grandfather?" That I knew him when he was a missionary in Japan. And as they talked, she discovered that he was an immigration attorney in Nevada, and he was able to help Kenny get his paperwork all together for the United States. That's how we met, his immigration attorney. It wasn't easy, but at least it was possible. And they were engaged in December of 2008. He arrived in the United States in June 2009. They were sealed in the book and temple in July. So there truly are anniversaries and miracles all throughout her life. They moved to St. Louis shortly after their marriage, finished her degree in nursing, and then moved to Idaho so Kenny could finish his degree in electrical engineering, and moved to Utah as well as they continued their professional careers.
No matter how busy Krista was, she was always pushing herself to learn new things or do new things. And Kenny was an amazing support to her. When there were times that she didn't think she could do something, he would say, "You can do it, go for it." Only probably with a Spanish accent. But he was always very supportive and encouraged her to do anything that she wanted, even if she didn't think she could. They loved to travel together. She loved to throw parties. She loved to bake, as we mentioned. She taught herself to sew quilts and embroider, and she completed quilts for family and friends, and even for her lost babies. Krista was an active member of the Rexy Writers, writing club up in Rexburg, with many close friends. She taught a number of budding authors how to start and how to get going with writing the books, and then provided more accomplished writers great assistance with her keen editing skills. Kenny and Krista have an amazing ability to bring people together. They make friendships and relationships everywhere, and that's really been one of their highest priorities for themselves, and encouraging relationships between others as well. And many, I know, of you have felt the benefit of them helping bring people together and connect, to feel a closeness that might not have been there otherwise. Kenny and Krista had a strong desire to have a family. In those early years, they were often involved in the nursery and just for fun, tending friends' children while they had a night off to go and do things. And they pursued, did everything in their power to have children, even with 3 rounds of unsuccessful IVF. And that effort and ongoing desire was unfortunately halted with the discovery of Krista's cancer. So Krista was preceded in her passing with 4 small children, Amelia, Seth, Christopher, and Nicholas. We are quite certain that Krista is up there taking care of them and teaching them what it's like to be here on Earth. And a little bit about what joy is and a little bit about what pain is. She truly understands now. We give our love to all of you and express our thanks for you being here. And again, express our love to him for his amazing support and love and faithfulness to Krista. And we say these things in the name of Jesus Christ.
Specifically, in 2018, I felt felt very strongly that I needed to stay up at BYU-Idaho in Rexburg, even though I wasn't going to school for a semester. And I had no idea why. It scared me half to death. I didn't have a job. I barely found housing. This is a very last-minute decision. This is the time when Krista started doing their first round of in vitro. And it was really hard for her. And so during that time, I spent almost every single day with her for 2 months. And we just talked, and she was in pain, so I cleaned her house or trying to get her food. I'm not a great cook. I'm glad she didn't die. But there was one night, and during this time as well, Kenny was on an internship where he was gone for 2 weeks at a time. So it was actually a really awesome time for Krista and I, one-on-one, to spend and to get to know each other really well. There was one night that I could tell something was off. She was kind of going through things. They were about to move to Utah, and I just looked at her and I said, "Something's wrong." And she started crying, and it was the first time that we really opened up to each other emotionally, not just for parties and get-togethers. And she told me that she felt stuck. She felt like she wasn't progressing because she and Kenny had been married for 8 years at this point, or had been an expert for 8 years at this point. And she said, "I thought by now I would have two kids or three kids, and I wouldn't be working, and Kenny would be graduated." And that's not what's happened. As she opened up, I started opening my heart a lot more to a deeper friendship with her. And that is probably the biggest blessing that could have happened in retrospect. She went through a lot of trials in the next following 5 years, in vitro, infertility, panic disorder, 2 major surgeries, 16 rounds of chemo, continuous chemo pump on top of that, and then going to hospice. But throughout that time, we spent countless hours on the phone together talking. Even after she moved, I was able to come down and visit a lot. Obviously, she went through a lot of physical trials through those things, but a lot of her hidden trials were more emotional and more spiritual, and I got to see a lot more of those trials because of the friendship we created in Rexburg. Emotionally, Krista had to stop ignoring her mental health, and that was really hard for her because she just wanted to be the happy, smiley girl who looked out for other people. She didn't want to bring anyone down. But for the first time, she had to face things, and her fears, her anger, her sadness, her disappointments. And as she peeled back those layers, she had to get to know herself in a whole new way. But she worked on it. She started therapy, and she started to find purpose in the trials that she was going through. That being said, she also felt a lot of grief. Grief of the ability to work when the cancer started to spread. Grief of losing her children in miscarriage. Grief of just a normal life. Being able to do normal things. And that was really hard for her. But over time, she started to learn how to grieve in a positive way. Spiritually, she also had a lot of struggles. She struggled with her relationship with her Heavenly Father for a while. She had a strong testimony that He existed and that He had power. But because of this, she felt really angry for a while, thinking, "Well, are you just abandoning me? Why am I having to go through these things? Haven't I learned what I need to learn?" But again, as she started peeling those layers back and started to get to know herself a little bit better on an emotional scale, She realized that it wasn't so much that she was angry with him, but more that she felt like she was disappointing him. That maybe if she had done something different or had acted in a different way, that this wouldn't be happening to her. And that he wouldn't be disappointed with her. And that was a really hard battle that she fought for a long time. But she never gave up on fixing her relationship with her Heavenly Father. And it took a long time. But over time, she realized that life can be really unfair. And sometimes prayers go unanswered. But that's okay. Because a lot of times that our prayers aren't being answered, it's because she was wanting him to change his will to be hers, rather than the other way around. In fact, she told me one time that in one of these moments when she was feeling like really abandoned and like she was a disappointment, she had a dream. And in this dream, Heavenly Father came to her. And he simply said, "I love you. I'm proud of you for how you've handled the trials that have been given you." Over time, she and Kenny had to learn that even though they had the faith to be healed, they had faith that she could be healed. They also needed to have the faith that she wouldn't be healed. And that through his will, through no matter what happened to Krista, something positive would come, and that it was okay. The last 5 years, obviously, she faced more than she would have ever expected, but she didn't let those trials stop her from growing and from progressing. She got a lot of things done on her bucket list, quilting, becoming a published author, playing on the Tabernacle organ, and a motherhood book, highlighting ways that she's been a mother in so many people's lives. In fact, the year before, this is something that she wrote on her Facebook page. She said, "Today we celebrated our 12th anniversary. It's weird looking back on the last 12 years and remembering how I imagined our lives would be. I definitely expected to have several kids and be settled by the time the 12-year mark came around. But unfortunately, life doesn't always follow plans. We've gone through our ups and downs, but I can honestly say the last year has definitely been one of the most defining years of our marriage. There have been plenty of downs, honestly. It feels like one after another. But we've also had many blessings. Small ones that have made it just a little bit easier. For me, the greatest blessing is having Kenny by my side." She knew Ken was her rock, and thank you. Because all these trials she went through, Kenny was right there with her. Throughout her life, she lived a life of charity. She was kind, she was resilient, and she brought a smile to everyone who knew her. So now, here we are, and all of us are having to figure out this process of grief that Krista started to figure out. It looks different for each of us, and right now our hearts are tender, but they have to be in order to see these tender mercies that will come from Krista's passing. And in our grief, I also think that it's important that although we want everything to happen for a reason, sometimes, and maybe always, it's a better mindset to have God help make reason of everything that's happening or that has happened. Life is really unfair. And in the end of Krista's life, life was really incredibly unfair for her. She was in a lot of pain. But as Krista put it, sometimes you just gotta enjoy the rain. Tragedies can become blessings. It will take time to figure out what those blessings are. But because of the Savior, Jesus Christ, the unfairness of life can actually become fair in our favor. And I think that that's what Krista would want for all of us. I think she would want us all to be able to find the joy and healing as she had to figure out through the last 5 years of her life. And as she's passed on now, having so much joy in this life, waiting for all of us to come join her at some point. I know that she wants all of us to continue on. And yes, of course, grieve, but also find joy, to heal, and to love, to continue the relationships that she helped us to find. I love her and I love this her dearly.
This moment for me and my family, it has been a very, how to say, hard learning and painful journey. However, the thing that I was mostly trying to do in the whole process of this is to smile. Try to make her happy, in this case, Krista. And every single time that I feel down, every single time that I was having these thoughts, then everything is not fair. Everything is going the way that we don't want to. The other part of me is saying, hey, Kenny, remember that you're not alone. Remember that you have your family. You have people who are supporting you. You have people, you have God. But in moments also came thoughts that say, you are not strong enough. You cannot do it. But something that I usually see from Krista was, like your parents pointed out, her smile. I was do as much as I can to keep that smile on her, to keep the happiness on her. Many people think that because of this process of sickness and everything, I did so much for her. But years before the cancer hit, I was doing things for her. For example, she's a nurse. She was a nightmare nurse. So her schedule of eating was very off. So breakfast, it was at 4 in the afternoon. Lunch, it was at midnight. And dinner, it was breakfast. So I kind of played all my schedule too. So about a couple times during the night, I say, hey, Kenny, I'm hungry. And I was like, okay, what do you want? No, what do I have? The only option that we have in Rexford, for example, it was McDonald's. We didn't have any other option. So, will you give me a big bag, please? And turn the car on and go and get the Big Mac. And usually get ice cream or what? Well, that's a lie. Usually the McDonald's doesn't have ice cream and Big Mac. They usually say, no, we don't have ice cream, so pretty much that happened to me every single night when she asked me for ice cream to go to McDonald's. So McDonald's and pretty much all the people who was over there get kind of think it's like, as usual? Yes, as usual. And pretty much that's my father like too with me when we went to restaurants. Usually I went to a couple restaurants and bring him and say, the people when they were the waiters and stuff, they know me, hey, can you hear me? And the same. So the only one who did it was my father-in-law who wants something different than I do. But anyway, let me pull my notes. Okay. Spain was interesting for me, in general. Spain, it was a place that I didn't expect it to be. My mom was there, my family was there, and they called me and said, can you come? I was like, okay, let's go. The first time I saw Krista, it was for a house of young single adults, me. She opened the door, called it there, and was like, greeting everyone with a smile. She was smiling over there, and the first thing I was going to the hall and I see, sounds a little bit like a movie, but the thing that I saw, it was a bright light over there on top of her, and she was so smiling, so much bright, and I was like, huh, she's cute. And the second thought when I asked, like, why is this young woman here? She needs to be in the other room. So, and then the next week, she was learning Spanish, and it was a moment from the class that usually actually asked to read that book from the Bible. We were reading the Bible. I was sitting back with my brother, and we were laughing a little bit to each other because we had a funny verse in the Bible, and it's like, I start teasing my brother about that. And Krista was about to read, and she was having a hard time reading. Because we were laughing in the back, she thought that we were laughing at her. And, say, and she said, the way that she said it, say, yeah, I try to remember the word that she said, when I saw you, I thought you were cute for me. Excuse me. And then they say, it's like, I hear so much laughing in the back, and she saw who it was. It's like, you're not going to be my friend. Because she thought that I was making fun of her when she was reading. So that was her first encounter. Apparently she didn't want to be my friend. And after that, because she was become the young single adult leader, so she's starting to invite people to come to the institute. Well, she comes like, hey, what are you doing? Like, she barely talked Spanish, so I was like, do you want to go to the institute? I said, okay. And it was a dancing class, it was every single class that you can remember from the institute, of Mormon, New Testament, and the new one was the dancing. So she invited me to that class, I went to that class, and I pretty much tell this story to many of you when I met my wife, and pretty much is, I was dancing with a girl I tried to date, and she was dancing with a boy, and the boy tried to date her. So we were in our own halls, different part of the room, and Brother Fixel, who was in charge of the institute, teaching us in that moment dancing class, and we tried to learn tango. And she said, he said, chain couple. And suddenly it's like, I was close to her, and you know, the girl that I was dancing was close to the boy. And the moment we started dancing, I didn't speak any English. The only thing I did was smile. She didn't speak any Spanish. And you know her smile, so we smiled to each other. Hi, hi. My name is Kenny, my name is Krista. She didn't ask me to open the window, so that was the only phrase I learned in English. Anyway, and she was, the only thing we did, it was dance. We laughed, we had a big smile, we had a good time to each other. It is true that we didn't speak any language in that moment, but the way that she described it in one of her videos she left, to me it was like, do you know the kindred spirit? I was like, in my head it's like, I have no idea what she said in the video. So that's how I felt with you when I met you, when we were dancing. I feel that you were my kindred spirit, and I feel that it was one of the things that I had. I didn't have any connection with another person over there in Spain until I met you when we danced. And I was like, oh. When, because Krista left a couple of videos, so that was one of the things that she is, her point of view at the moment we were dancing. And after that, we never danced to another couple in our lives. So that was the beginning of our journey, the beginning of the dancing partner that I have with me in this moment. And I need to be sorry. And grateful that usually Brother Pixel say, I don't know, probably saying chain couples in the moment they happen to make it possible the way it happens. One of her videos, she tried to, the way that she tried to say goodbye, it was through videos. So she did a couple of videos in her phone. And she said, I would like to tell you something, Memo. I would like to tell you something that you can remember. I want to tell you something happy. However, my brain is almost, and I, with all these issues that I have, it, the only thing that I can remember it was Wildcats to the End. I don't know where that came from, but I think it's from High School Musical. So she started laughing in that moment, and some of the things they pointed out the most, it was, I'm very grateful that you take care of me and give me all your energy and support in this moment. And something then she pointed out, and many people see on her right, she like a person who achieved every single goal, every single thing that she did. And she told me that without you, I couldn't make the things anything. In the same way well for me. Without her, I couldn't reach the person that I am now. Because I came to a different country. The culture is totally different. And whoever, this is me. Whoever said that the first year of marriage is a wonderful, he's a liar. It's wonderful to be with the person that you love. It's wonderful to be, you know, waking up with her. But man, the cultural stuff, the family things, the clothes over there, the, you know, whoever got married the first year, it's a challenge. Because you actually start meeting the person that you love. And I don't say that you don't want to date that person, but you're trying to work through to make it possible to live to each other for, in this case, eternity. So you need, there's a lot of, I don't say fights, because first of all, I didn't speak English. She speaks Spanish, so she has an advantage. So she usually gets angry at me, she's explaining everything, but I couldn't say anything to English. I couldn't speak any English. The only thing, like I told you before, the only thing that I like was open the window. So, and the other thing is like, it's helpful, like, what is the bathroom, I'm thirsty, and I'm hungry, and that's it. Like, I can understand mostly the English reading, but talking, see, nothing, nada. Anyway, something then I was reading, and I was thinking a lot of her, because she said, like, she was blaming herself so many times because of the illness that she had. And most of the time she was not depressed, but so she couldn't go outside, enjoy the grass, she couldn't go outside, see the lights, she couldn't do that much by herself, then she was chafed in the bed. And something that I tell her was that I didn't quit on you. I didn't run away. I'm going to keep the moment for as long as I can, for as long as I have, I'm with you. That's pretty much what I remember saying to her. And I'm going to her, going to be with her as much as I am. Sorry, the Spanish cannot move. Anyway, I'm going to be with you, I say, hermosa. I'm going to be with you as much as you let me be with you. If it's going to be 2 minutes, it's going to be an hour, it's going to be a month. It doesn't matter how much it will take for me or whatever time it is, I'm going to be with you. And again, that's pretty much for me that if she was very supportive to me, and I will try to give it that support that she gave me before to her. She was like, one of her videos says, like, I try to take care of myself as much as I can, but as you know, the illness, I couldn't do it. So for me, the way that I showed love to her, it was like, she wanna pumpkin bread from Needers. Okay, let's go and read it. She wants, I don't know, McDonald's, what is it called? A Big Mac. I was going to that. And for me, I did it with my love and with all the things and I feel for her because I know that she will have a smile after I bring it up. And as everyone knows, and also the nurses, the CNAs, many family, the first thing when say, you know, you came to the room and say, hi, they say, hi. But she always was smiling. She always tried to be the positive way, but also she has troubles on her. She was dealing with depression, she was dealing with loss of babies, she was dealing with cancer. However, try to help her as much as I can, whatever I have in my hands. So if it's a pumpkin bread to make a smile, okay, thank you. It was going to, for example, it was hard for her to shower, so I helped her to go and shower. So I was doing as much as I can to help her. One of the things then I see in the one of the books, it's some a couple of questions, right? And I ask her, so some significant accomplishment in your life, and she told me, it's like, one, it was being a nurse. She always tried to be determined to be a nurse, and she did. She was a nurse, and she loved to help people. The second one, then she said, was write a book. Well, she had already 12, so. I don't know what she was talking about. However, the part of the writing book was to be Polish. She already did. And thanks to all the family for doing that both for her and doing the Polish part. And she make a public, she published the book. The third one that she said was doing a quip. That was something that she was always wanted to learn, and she did. You can see the quilt over there. She was hot. In the end, because she couldn't stitch it, she had help from the ward, and I'm very grateful to the ward for helping finishing the quilt. And another one, it was being director of nursing in a new facility. So that was in Rexburg. So she was a director of nurse over there in Rexburg for, I don't know, long, I guess. Another question that I read and to her and I must begin, it was, if you live your life again, what would you change? She said, I won't change anything. Because without the things that I have done and thanks to you, I made it. Pretty much whatever she had in life, she won't change it. Everything she did, from being a nurse, being a writer, being a sister, and all of that she was doing, she was happy with the things that she did. It is true that maybe there are a few tweaks she might do it, but in general, she said, thanks to you, I'm here. And I say to her the same too. Thanks to her, I'm here. The man that I am, it will be without her. The man that you see that who speak English right now and pursue a bachelor's degree, who plays soccer as much as he wants, wouldn't be without her. She was my home. So it's kind of hard for me right now that I'm home. Well, she's taking home, so I don't know what it's going to be with me, but I don't know, like I say to everyone, I'm grateful for her, for everything that she did for me. I think, like I told you before, without her, I don't think so I would be the man that I am right now. So, another thing, it was favorite place. They commented Nauvoo. So Nauvoo, it was one of the favorite places to be in Earth. They didn't want to go to Hawaii. Hawaii, I don't know why. I would like to go to Hawaii. come back to Madrid and visit the places again that we met, like we were dating. And it's incredible that she say also Alexi. She likes to be here. She likes the place that we were living, and she likes the people that she met here too. And something that I asked her too, what will be one thing that you want your family to remember? She said, my determination. I want the people that I love, and they love me, to remember like how determined I was with the things that I tried to do. With the things that I was having goals. That was pretty much what he said, she said in general. Yeah, sorry, I'm kinda, I was a little bit hard watching the TV, seeing the pictures on the TV, on the computer. I remember every single year that we passed, and I think our best year that we had together, it was 2019. Why? Because she lost 2018, she lost babies. So she was in a lot of depression for 3 months that I didn't know how to help. I was dealing with that and I tried to help as much as I can, but sometimes the person who's in depression, it has a little bit hard in general. Even though you want to help, you don't know how to help. So I was a supporting husband. Whatever she was handling, I went for. Whatever she wants to get out, I went with her. So 2019, it was the year and the months before she was having her therapist, and something that she started to do in 2019, it was doing one new thing every month. So the months of January, she never held a puppy. So January was holding a puppy. She was afraid, she was doing anything, and when she held the puppy, it's like, what do I do with this? But she never did. She was always scared with the dog, she was always scared with the cats. But she said, I was going to try something new in this year. So January was the year when she tried everything new. So another thing that she did for that year is eat an octopus. So, well, the Lexi Ride does know about the octopus bar. So it was one season and she liked octopus a lot. A lot, a lot, a lot. And you saw the stuffed animal. That's the reason that we have that, because she liked octopus. And she say, I'm going to try something new. So she's trying octopus. She didn't like it, but she tried it. Something new that we tried, it was going to New York. In New York, in general, I know, I was thinking in May, like I need to do something for Krista, then it's not going to be remarkable. And we were listening Come From Away, a Broadway show related with September 11th, and different places in the U.S. So my father was like, I would like to give you something, like to go to this in New York, Broadway. And we finished a project and we have what is called Sugar House. And that's when we had the bonus and I said, Krista, it's now or never. You have money, do the tickets. Let's go. So I gave the money to her, and she kind of arranged all the trip for New York. The Airbnb, the tickets, and I was the one in charge of the plane. So I said, let's go to Broadway. And she was so happy to be in Broadway. She was so happy to enjoy the musical. She was so happy to see all the things that happened in New York, because we kind of were dating again in that place. Because you feel like Madrid. Somehow the city, somehow the rush and everything for my last when we were younger, going to the people here in my head and my back, and we kind of touched the people walking everywhere. It was wonderful. It was a good experience for her and for me. Something else that happened that year, she had a surgery. Well, that happened before, but had a surgery. I would like to say thank you to everyone. Thank you for being with us in this moment, for anyone who's there, hi. And thank you for being there. En español, a todos los que están en español, gracias por estar aquí. Tal vez me escuchen, pero yo no lo escucho a ustedes, así que... thank you everyone for being here, supporting this moment for us. I know that I would like to be in this moment to be with you guys. So thank you. And the last thing I would like to do next. This is one thing that I asked Lisa before everything, so...
A message to my family and friends. What would you say?
Sad than I feel right now. I Right now, a very sweet feeling. I feel happy because she is resting from the pain. But also, I feel sad because she's resting away with me. Thank you, everyone. And I know the gospel is true. And I say this thing in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
What a wonderful tribute. And I'd just like to express the love of our Lord to Kenny and to Blanchard family and to the Quintana family. This journey has, we've been fortunate enough to be a part of this journey for the past couple of years, and want to thank you and just express my love to you. I just have a few remarks that I'd like to share with everybody today, and I know for the sake of time, we'll keep them short. You know, brothers and sisters, the fullness of the gospel of Jesus Christ was designed to bring about our immortality and eternal life. Heavenly Father didn't say, oh, it's going to be an easy road. He didn't say it's going to be a piece of cake, or it's going to be just happiness all the time and joy. But the plan of our Heavenly Father is the plan of happiness. It included the creation. It included the fall. It included the atonement of our Savior Jesus Christ. It included physical death. And also resurrection. But also part of that plan included the laws and commandments of the gospel from our Heavenly Father. It also included all of the wonderful holy ordinances which we are able to participate in, the doctrines that we are able to share in, that we are able to follow. The wonderful part of the plan, though, is that Heavenly Father gave us agency. He gave us an opportunity to follow this plan, and of course, we're all here today because we chose to follow that plan. Our purpose, of course, was to gain a physical body here on this earth, and while on this earth, experience all the experiences of joy, peace, sorrow, pain, adversity, but most importantly, to grow and to learn and become like Him. Our earthly trials, of course, help us to become more like Him. Most essential to the plan, of course, was our Savior Jesus Christ and His atoning sacrifice for us. He overcame physical death and He overcame spiritual death. I'd like to read a scripture that's found in Alma chapter 7, verses 11 through 13. That scripture reads as follows. And he shall go forth, suffering pains and afflictions and temptations of every kind. And this, that the word might be fulfilled, which saith he will take upon himself the pains and the sickness of his people. And he will take upon him death, that he may loose the bands of death, which bind his people. And he will take upon him their infirmities, that his bowels may be filled with mercy according to the flesh, that he may know according to the flesh how to succor his people according to their infirmities. Now the Spirit knoweth all things, nevertheless the Son of God suffereth according to the flesh, that he might take upon him the sins of his people, that he might blot out their transgressions according to the power of his deliverance. And now behold, this is the testimony which is in me. Prophet Alma explains so well the sacrifice of our Savior Jesus Christ and what he went through for us. Sister Quintana suffered many trials throughout her life. I think she probably experienced just an inkling of what our Savior Jesus Christ experienced. But the wonderful thing is that our physical bodies will eventually die, but we also will have an opportunity to be reunited with our Heavenly Father. That physical body will be able to be reunited with our spirit. What a wonderful opportunity it is, brothers and sisters, that we have, as well as Sister Quintana has, to be resurrected and to be made alive again in Christ. In Moses 1:39, we read, "For behold, this is my work and my glory to bring to pass the immortality and eternal life of man." It's truly what life is about, is eternal life, the opportunity to live with our Heavenly Father again, to be able to live together as families forever. Eternal life is what we need to look forward to. My testimony, brothers and sisters, is that we will endure. In the scriptures, we read to trust in the Lord with all our hearts, and lean not unto our own understanding, but in all thy ways acknowledge him, and he will direct our paths. As we lean on him, we will find that eternal happiness, that eternal joy that is wonderful, and have an opportunity to be able to return to live with him. I bear that testimony to you, and I want everyone to know that I love the gospel of Jesus Christ. I know that it's true. I know we have a Savior who loves us. I know that as family, as you move forward, that as you trust in the Lord, he will take care of you as a family. He will bless you. Crystal will continue to bless your lives as you trust in our Heavenly Father. And I'll leave that with you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Our closing hymn will be Families Together Forever, Can Be Together Forever, hymn 300. We'd like to thank all of those who have participated and helped in the funeral arrangements, the family luncheon, and any other activities associated to the funeral. Our benediction will be then given by Brother Guillermo Quintana. The dedication of the grave will be, and the interment will be held at American Fork Cemetery. The address is located in your program. Thank you, brothers and sisters, for being here today.
cristiano. Queremos agradecerte por estos momentos tan especiales, tan difíciles, pero con la convicción de que tu plan se cumple en cada momento. Gracias, amado Padre, por la oportunidad que nos diste de ser bendecido con Cristo en nuestras vidas. Gracias, amado Padre, por la familia que le diste, porque permitiste mucho más que en un lugar y se ha incluido en nuestros principios. Gracias, amado Padre, por permitirnos haberla conocido, compartir con ella su vida, recibir su amor y darnos siempre un buen ejemplo en todas las cosas que ella sabía. Rogamos, amado Padre, que nuestros corazones siempre puedan guardar esas cosas que recibimos y que aprendimos de ellos. Que nos ayudes a conservar su legado y que también podamos seguir su camino. Bendice a su Padre, amado Padre, para que podamos recibir el consuelo a todos nosotros que podamos también seguir adelante. Amado Padre, que hagamos oraciones y bendiciones para todos los que están interesados. Rogamos, Señor Padre, que tu plan y tu misericordia esté con nosotros. Amado Padre, eternamente agradecido por todo lo que nos das y porque sabemos que tú nos llevarás siempre y nos darás siempre las cosas que necesitamos. Nos las diste a través de Cristo y seguiremos hacia el futuro de Dios. Rogamos estas bendiciones en el nombre de Jesucristo.